Hello everyone, my name is Randy Johnson. I'm a tour guide here in Charleston, South Carolina, working for Bulldog Tours. We consider ourselves essential, but I guess during this trying time we are essentially non-essential. But every now and then, we are coming out here on the streets of Charleston and in other famous landmarks here in the city and around it to offer tours. And the one we're giving tonight on this beautiful Friday night is a story that involves Edgar Allan Poe. And before I get to that, I want to give people plenty of time to log on and join us on this live video. And I just want to welcome everybody, and I also want to wish everyone a very meaningful Good Friday. Of course, we're all celebrating in our homes, and this Sunday will be a very important day. It will be Easter here in the Holy City. And as you can hear right now in the background, you can hear the bells of St. Philip's. And pretty soon they will all be chiming in. And by the way, some of these bells are some of the last bells in church steeples in the United States that are still pulled by hand. And on occasion, congregants are given the opportunity to go up into the belfry and ring the bells themselves. I haven't had that chance yet. If I do, it will probably be at Grace Cathedral. Over on Wentworth, but I would like to share with you tonight a story that is near and dear to me. And keep in mind that this is a ghost story, and ghost stories are based upon two things: historic fact and lore. And I personally, love ghost stories because it gives you a certain more artistic license when telling stories, and this is by far one of my favorites. So why am I here? Why am I standing here of all places in the city if I'm going to talk about my hero, Edgar Allan Poe? Well, where we are standing right now, on King Street, just down a ways from Dufane, where it crosses and turns into Market, is a spot directly across from the Charleston Library Society, and it's called the Gateway Path. And the Gateway Path, as you can see, goes a long way down, about 2 to 3 blocks, goes all the way down to Archdale Street, and that's where it starts. And it doesn't end where I'm standing. It continues going east across from where I am. And let me explain how it's laid out. In 1930, a group of wonderful ladies here in the city, the Charleston Garden Club, came together and were able to obtain easements and laid out a beautiful walk that started actually, and still does, in the graveyard at St. John's Lutheran Church on Archdale. And where it starts there, you then walk over into the Unitarian Church graveyard, which is at the very end of this long path on the right-hand side. And of course, the Unitarian Church graveyard is unique in the city because it's the only graveyard here in the old city that was allowed to become lush. And over the years, the horticulturalists who have taken and put their hearts into this thing have imported exotic plants, bushes, and trees from all over the world. And it is a beautiful place where one can commune with your soul. It continues this way, and then it crosses here. And if you go right over there, that's the Charleston Library Society. And if you go to that side there, it takes you back. There's an archway, and it goes back behind the Charleston Library Society, and you actually go into the back of the Gibbs Art Gallery, which faces Meeting Street. And then you walk around a path to the north side of the Gibbs Art Gallery, and then you cross over Meeting Street, and it takes you into the graveyard at the Circular Congregational Church. And you follow the same path through the graveyard at the Circular Congregational Church, continuing to go east. And then on lucky days, there's a gate back there that sometimes is open that allows you to do the last section of the Gateway Path and Gateway Walk. And you go through there into the cemetery across the street from St. Philip's Church. You then go up to the front gate of that cemetery, cross Church Street, and enter into the graveyard at St. Philip's Church, which is where the Gateway Walk ends. If you want more information on the Gateway Walk, look up the Garden Club's website and they'll explain it in more detail. highly recommend as something to do here in the city, especially in the prettier months, because it's just a beautiful, very serene walk with the path lined by ferns and other exotic plants. So why am I here, though, if I'm talking about Edgar Allan Poe? Well, where I am here at this entrance here to the Gateway Walk, I've been known, and most guides here in the city have been known, to bring their groups late at night. And we stand here to tell stories. And over the years, some very strange things have happened. Just last summer, on one of my tours, I actually happened to be giving a talk here, and a lady in my group started to shake, looked over at me, and screamed this very strange kind of blood-curdling scream, and fainted. Luckily, her husband caught her, and we were able to bring her to. She had some water, recovered, and insisted on leaving the tour immediately. Over the years, similar things have happened to other guides. And when pressed, and this always seems to affect women more than men, but when you press these women about this reaction they have, this physical reaction, this emotion of abject terror, they will tell you that what triggers their fear, hold on just a second. By the way, just a little aside, I have a theory about people who drive around in loud vehicles and motorcycles. If you remember when you were a kid and you would go to the community swimming pool with the high dive, and you would see people climbing up to the high dive to dive into the pool, there was always that one little sad boy who would climb up to the top of the high dive, and he would look down before he would dive, and he would call out to his mother, "Mommy, Mommy, look!" And his mom would never look. That's what happens to those boys. They spend the rest of their lives trying to get their mother's attention. We have sympathy for them, and if you ever see one of them making that kind of noise, just walk up and say, "Darling, I'm so sorry your mama didn't love you." Anyway, back to the story. What causes this reaction in these women? Well, when pressed, they will tell you. They see, just down here, floating, hovering off the ground, the apparition of a beautiful woman, a young lady, probably in her late teens, in a tattered dress that appears to be a wedding dress. And as she gets closer and closer, of course, that's when they panic and they scream and often swoon or faint. Well, who is this ghost that people see floating down toward this gate from the very, very far back of this path? Well, for the longest time, Charlestonians would have told you that, of course, that's the ghost of Lavinia Fisher, America's first female serial killer, who is alleged to have murdered somewhere between 70 and 100 men back in 18 and early 1819 with her husband, John Fisher. They were hanged over on Line Street, just a few blocks north of here, in February of 1820. And there was a rumor that circulated for a long time after their execution that Lavinia Fisher had been buried secretly in an unmarked grave inside the Unitarian Church graveyard. And of course, people just naturally assumed that this young lady that people see here floating up from the back must be Lavinia Fisher. Well, it isn't. We have done some tracing. Lavinia Fisher, her body was either buried in a potter's field under what is still today the Psychiatric Institute of the Medical University over on Barry Street, or more likely, her body was diverted and dissected in front of medical students sometime immediately after her death. However, who is this ghost then? Who is this apparition that terrorizes the women who come here on tour? Well, I'll tell you who it is. And it's a young lady, of course, who died back in 1828. And her name, Annabel Lee Ravenel. Now, Annabel Lee wouldn't necessarily ring a bell with anyone unless you know a little bit more about her. And let me tell you, back in 1827, Annabel Lee was the daughter of a very wealthy man here in the city who had fallen on some hard times. His name was Dr. Edmund Ravenel. And they had a beautiful house over on Broad Street, just next to Washington Park. But they had fallen on hard times, and they were struggling to maintain their position here socially in the city. And Annabel Lee had had a debutante party. She had been debuted to all of the wealthy young men here in the city, and she was being courted. But at some point in 1827, We're not quite sure how it happened. Annabelle Lee was introduced to a very handsome and very charming young soldier. And this young soldier, we're not sure, may have met her on the beach at Sullivan's Island, where her family had a shack where they would go during the hot summer months to escape the heat here in the city. Or she may have met him somewhere down on Bufane Street at the corner of St. Philip, where there used to be a finishing school for fine young ladies here in the city. And that is also a possibility. We may never know for sure. His name? Well, at the time, he was going by the name of Edgar Allan Perry. But that wasn't his real name. His real name was Edgar Allan Poe. And Edgar Allan Poe, as you know, had a tragic life. His mother died when he was a very young boy. He was not even 3 years old when his mother passed. He was born in 1849. He had had some contact with Charleston in the past when he was a little baby. His mother had actually performed here at the Charleston Theater and also at the Dock Street. And back then, though, he was so young, we doubt he would have remembered much of that. He wound up in New England. He wound up in Richmond, wound up in Boston, wound up in Philadelphia and New York City. But at some point, he had been adopted by the Allen family, which is the folks who gave him his middle name. And Edgar Allan Poe had gone off to the University of Virginia at a very young age to study, and had fallen on hard times, had run up gambling debts, and was being chased and hounded by creditors. And back then, you could go to jail for being a debtor. And so Edgar Allan Poe felt it prudent to avoid his creditors by joining the U.S. Army under an assumed name, even lied about his age. It was not even 18 when he joined. Well, he was stationed in Boston initially, but then he was reassigned to Charleston and wound up in the barracks across the harbor at Sullivan's Island at Fort Moultrie. And he would be sent into the city periodically by his regimental commander to take care of regimental business. He would be put up at the what is now the King Charles Inn. Back then it was called the Pavilion Hotel down on Meeting Street. And walked around the city, probably fell in love with the city. Given his inclinations toward the more gothic things in life. And Charleston, of course, is well suited for that. It's also possible that he met Dr. Edmund Ravenel, Annabelle Lee's dad, at the beach at Sullivan's Island, because they both shared this very interesting hobby. They were both what back then are still people call conchologists. He liked to collect shells and label them. And these two men shared that love for shells. And that may have been another way in which they met. In any event, we're not sure if Dr. Ravenel introduced his daughter to Edgar or whether Edgar ran into her while he was here in the city, but the two of them fell madly in love. This was the love of your life. This was not just puppy love. This was the love of the gods. This is the kind of stuff that makes the angels jealous. And when Dr. Ravenel, sorry, I'm eating a mosquito. They don't taste very good, but they're high in protein. Anyway, Edgar Allan Poe and Annabelle Lee were seen together more and more. And word got back to Dr. Ravenel, and he was furious. He called his daughter up in the house one evening and said, "Sweetheart, are you dating this no good soldier from Baltimore? What's his name? Edgar Allan, whatever. I mean, I don't really care. What I want you to understand is you can't date that young man. I have high aspirations for you. I'm going to marry you off to one of these nabobs downtown South Abroad. You stay away from that young man." Well, Annabelle Lee was a good daughter. And what do good daughters do? Go behind her dad's back. So she and Edgar began to meet secretly at night, late at night, in the graveyard at the Unitarian Church at the back of this long alley. And their love flourished. Now, I've read a lot about Edgar Allan Poe. I think he had some really bad demons that he had to deal with in his later life. But I think at this early stage, he was probably quite the gentleman. This was a very chaste relationship. And my guess is, hidden somewhere in the back of that dark Unitarian Church graveyard at night, this was an exchange of poetry, expressions of love, and sweet, chaste kisses on the cheek, and nothing more. Well, anyway, this goes on for a few months, and at some point, Dr. Ravenel gets word of it, and he waits one night for Annabelle to return from her secret meeting with Edgar at their house on Broad, and he says, "Sweetheart, Darling, is it true? Are you still dating this young man I told you not to see? And to her credit, Annabelle was a good daughter, did not lie to her father, and she said, yes, father, I am in love with Edgar, and I want to live with Edgar for the rest of my life. I'm going to marry Edgar. Well, her father noticed a box under her bed, and when he pulled it out and opened it, discovered a wedding dress. Didn't take him long to figure out that Annabelle Lee was about to elope with this young man, and he was going to stop it. So like any good father, he took drastic measures and locked his daughter in her bedroom and told her, sweetheart, I'll let you out as soon as you see reason. Well, she wasn't going to see reason, and she doubled down and went on a hunger strike, telling her father she would not eat again until she saw her beloved Edgar. And Edgar, to his credit, came across the harbor every chance he got and knocked on the door of the Ravenel's home, very politely but very pleadingly asking that Dr. Ravenel allow him to see his beloved Annabelle Lee. And Dr. Ravenel would chase him off. And this went on for a little while, but in the late summer of 1828, Annabelle Lee's been stuck in that room for a long time, and come to think of it, I think given what's happening in the world today, I think we can all understand her frustration at being quarantined, so to speak, in her room. At that time, Charleston was afflicted by the yellow fever, and an outbreak occurred. Now, back then, they did not know how it spread. They thought you got the fever by breathing the miasma, those obnoxious fumes that come up from the pluff mud here along the marsh of the city. They did not understand that it is spread by mosquito bites. Well, Annabelle Lee was bitten by a mosquito carrying the virus. And within a few short days, because of her weak state from her hunger strike, she died very quickly. And her father was devastated. Word got to Edgar. He was devastated. And Dr. Ravenel, at that point, went off the deep end. And I'll tell you something about Charlestonians. We're all very normal until we're not. We just coast along, and then at some point, we go off the deep end. Just like our churches, we lean slightly. Edgar Allan Poe wanted to attend her funeral, and her father got word of that. And he was first went into, of course, a long period of grief, but then when he came out of the grief, he got angry. And Dr. Ravenel blamed Edgar Allan Poe for the loss of his daughter. And he resolved then and there to do something rather remarkable and macabre. He told the grave digger at the Unitarian Church to dig not one grave for his daughter, but six, all in different places, away from their normal plot. And on the appointed afternoon, they held the funeral. They kept Edgar Allan Poe away. They took her body into the graveyard. They picked one of those graves randomly, and they buried her. Then they filled all six graves at the same time, and it worked. Edgar Allan Poe showed up looking for the grave of his beloved and was never sure which grave she was in. And if you read the poem Annabelle Lee, it often, if you read it in between the lines, you realize that he talks about not being sure if she's there, laying on the ground, trying to get as close to her as he can, and cursing her high-born kinsman for taking her away from him. And so, who is this beautiful apparition who haunts this area right here, walking up and down the gateway walk? Of course, it's Annabelle Lee, the ghost of Annabelle Lee. I encourage you all to come here late at night. Perhaps if you look down there yourselves, you may be privy to her apparition. But one thing I want to end with is this, and it's something I've always shared with my guests at the ends of tours, and it's a quote from Edgar Allan Poe, and I'm going to share it with you now. So in this appropriate mask, this steampunk mask, I want to recite for you a little piece of Edgar Allan Poe that resonates with me because I think it encapsulates what this city is all about. And so I'm going to channel Edgar here for a second. For my own part, I have never had a thought which I could not set down in words with even more distinctness than that with which I conceived it. There is, however, a class of fancies of exquisite delicacy which are not thoughts, and to which as yet I have found it absolutely impossible to adapt to language. These fancies arise from deep within the human soul, alas, very rarely and only at epochs of intense tranquility, such as the early hours of the morning, or at strange points of distortion in the fabric of time itself, does it become possible for the confines of the waking world to blend into the world of dreams. And so, Charleston has captured these fancies, giving rise to a city where everything that you see or think you see is but a dream within a dream. Thank you so much, and I hope you enjoyed it. Are there any questions? Do you see any down there? Joy's my camera person. All right. Well, anyway, I love doing this. I hope to do some more for you. I know other folks are going to be on history tours. I think there may be one tomorrow. And I think we have another ghost tour tomorrow, also at 8 o'clock, which will be with Joy. And I'll let her share that with you when the time comes. But anyway, happy Good Friday, and God bless everybody. Bye-bye.